After informed consent, we perform MIP for lower pull stones starting from 8 millimeters in the case of medial and superior calyceal stones, and starting from 15 millimeters in diameter in the case of renal pelvic stones. Other indications include calyceal diverticular stones and anatomical variations, and persistence of stones following ESWL. The only absolute contraindications are coagulation disorders, pregnancy, acute urinary tract infections, and extreme obesity. We use a universal cystourethroscope with a 30-degree field of view and a 7 French instrument channel. The rounded tip permits atraumatic insertion of the instrument. A special endoscope and a complete instrument set have been developed for minimally invasive PCNL. The two larger dilators have an additional channel, which allows secure placement in the renal collecting system after puncture. The correct position is demonstrated by the backflow of dyed contrast media. A second guide wire can be inserted through this working channel if necessary. The nephroscope sheaths are available in 3 different sizes. All sheaths have a specially designed trumpet-shaped end, which facilitates introduction of the nephroscope. In the 2 larger sheaths, the hydrodynamic properties create a vacuum cleaner effect, which permits rapid removal of stones up to 4 millimeters in size by irrigation without additional deployment of instruments. This vacuum cleaner effect, achieved by the low pressure irrigation flow, enhances patient safety. The nephroscope with a 12-degree field of view has a reinforced sheath in order to prevent breakage. Rigid instruments and probes up to 5 French can be used. The angled eyepiece allows free access and manipulation. Automatic pressure control is achieved by the special design of the nephroscope and of the 2 larger sheaths. The rotatable instrument and irrigation connector facilitates visualization during nephroscopy. Forceps are used for manipulating the guide wire and double J catheter. The branches, which open on both sides, appear in the surgeon's field of view early on, thus improving gripping. The nephroscope's light port is positioned at the top. The access points for the irrigation fluid are positioned at a slight angle in order to maintain free access to the working channel. A radiopaque applicator with obturator can be used to introduce hemostatic agents. The Foley catheter is connected to the urine bag and the balloon catheter fixed to the buttocks under slight tension. Before draping the patient, optimal positioning is checked again using ultrasound and the ideal puncture point is marked on the skin. This is followed by sterile washing, draping of the patient, and preparation of the instrument set. Rapid and safe surgery requires optimal positioning of the X-ray and endoscopy monitors and a practical arrangement of the feeds for irrigation, ultrasound, light and camera cables, and, if relevant, for lithotripsy. Being connected to the endoscopy monitor, the ultrasound unit can be located some distance away from the surgical field. The team, consisting of the surgeon and the scrub nurse, must be able to reach the surgical field comfortably. This permits effective and fatigue-free surgery, so that the duration of the operation can be optimized. Through the balloon catheter's working channel, the renal collecting system is gently filled with blue-dyed contrast medium. X-ray monitoring is used to prevent an intrarenal reflux. The puncture guide is attached to the ultrasound probe. The multipart puncture needle is inserted into the guide after pulling the needle tip back into the sheath. This prevents deformation of the tip. After applying ultrasound contact gel, the puncture is performed. The puncture is carried out through the papillae of the posterior calyx of the stone-bearing calyceal group. The axial alignment of the access with the calyx should be preferred, minimizing the risk of bleeding by avoiding injury to larger renal vessels. Moreover, ultrasound-guided puncture minimizes injury to adjacent organs. X-ray monitoring in the second plane helps to confirm the exact location of the needle tip. Once the stylet is removed, blue-dyed contrast medium flows out of the needle and urine is collected for microbiological examination. A flexible guide wire with a hydrophilic tip is introduced into the renal collecting system via the puncture needle and positioned in the superior calyceal group or in the ureter. The flexible tip prevents perforation of the renal parenchyma. After removing the ultrasound probe, a skin incision is made, followed by withdrawing the puncture needle and securing the guide wire at skin level. Under X-ray control, the metal bougie is carefully screwed over the guide wire in the axis of the puncture channel until the renal collecting system is reached. The only situation where a two-step bougie may be necessary is in patients who have previously undergone surgery and who have a scarification in the retroperitoneal space. The correct position of the bougie in the renal collecting system is confirmed by blue contrast medium, which flows out of the second channel. The nephroscopy sheath is screwed over the manually secured metal bougie. The bougie is then removed and the guide wire secured. After switching on the endoscopy monitor, the nephroscope is inserted into the renal collecting system along the guide wire and another safety wire is introduced. It's positioned either in the superior calyceal group or in the ureter. Then the nephroscope and the nephroscopy sheath are removed and the metal bougie is inserted into the renal collecting system over the guide wire. The safety wire is now fixed in the access tract between the instrument and the parenchyma and is additionally secured with a clamp. The nephroscope sheath is then placed parallel to the guide wire. Reinsertion of the nephroscope is followed by overview nephroscopy. Attention is then focused on the stone. The stone is trapped between the lithotripsy probe and the urothelium and then fragmented with the lithotripter. During ballistic lithotripsy, it's important not to increase the pressure on the stone any further in order to prevent urothelial lesions. Similarly, direct pounding of the urothelium leads to contact bleeding. Lithotripsy should therefore only be carried out when the tip of the probe is directly visible. Fragmenting to a grain size of 3 to 4 millimeters has proved ideal for the fastest possible extraction, even of larger calculi. Fragments of this size can be retrieved without forceps or dormier baskets by exploiting the irrigation flow and the resulting vacuum cleaner effect. This effect exists without any increase in intrarenal pressure. It's only necessary to focus on the stone fragment to be retrieved with the nephroscope. The vacuum cleaner effect causes it to remain in front of the nephroscope, which is now slowly retracted. Once the funnel-shaped sheath end is reached, the suction is interrupted by rotating the nephroscope upwards, and the stone fragment falls out of the sheath. Stone dust is removed passively at the same time by this effect. Sharp-edged fragments, which do not separate from the fornices, are retrieved with a dormier basket. Although with appropriate fragmenting, this is rarely necessary. Once endoscopy has demonstrated the absence of calculi, the renal collecting system is examined once again, first without and then with contrast medium, in order to detect residual fragments or extravasation. The urethral balloon catheter is now deflated and the end piece removed. A guide wire is advanced in retrograde fashion through the urethral balloon catheter into the kidney and pulled out through the nephroscopy sheath with forceps. Simultaneous retrograde pushing of the guide wire facilitates its retrieval. This is followed by removal of the urethral balloon catheter. A steerable, variable-length urethral stent is introduced over the guide wire in antegrade fashion, initially up to the mid-third of the ureter. The guide wire is then advanced through the stent into the bladder, with its hydrophilic tip pointing forward. Correct positioning of the stent is confirmed via X-ray, and after removing the guide wire, the pushing device is removed. The gelatin thrombin matrix is prepared by the scrub nurse in accordance with the manufacturer's instructions. Before application of the gelatin thrombin matrix, the nephroscope is inserted again and the correct position of the urethral stent in the renal pelvis is confirmed. The nephroscope's sheath is now withdrawn under visual control to just behind the parenchyma pylon margin. The safety wire is now removed. When the irrigating flow is interrupted, a backdrop phenomenon of the urothelium appears, which during the subsequent application of the gelatin thrombin matrix creates a barrier to the renal collecting system. The syringe containing the gelatin thrombin matrix is screwed onto the applicator and the latter is inserted in the nephroscope sheath. The gelatin thrombin matrix is applied in the access tract as uniformly as possible via stepwise withdrawal of the sheath. The remaining substance is inserted at the renal capsule with the help of the pushing device. The wound is now closed with sterile strips. Following the intervention on the first post-operative day, the absence of residual fragments is documented by a KUB and extravasation is ruled out by ultrasound examination. The Foley catheter is removed. The double J stent is removed after about a week in stone-free patients. If residual fragments are still present, a flexible URS is carried out during the following weeks. The results of minimally invasive percutaneous nephrolithotripsy, MIP, have been documented in 89 patients in a prospective analysis. With a mean stone burden of 2.4 square centimeters, the mean duration of surgery from puncture to tract closure was 57 minutes in total. The primary stone-free rate was over 92%. The complications of MIP are minor. Hemorrhage was measured as a mean hemoglobin decrease of 1.5 milligrams per deciliter. 7 patients had a post-operative fever episode with a measured temperature above 38.5 degrees Celsius. In addition, 7 urinary tract infections were diagnosed, and in 2 patients it was necessary to replace the occluded urethral catheter. None of the patients experienced post-operative sepsis or bleeding that required transfusion. A high stone-free rate is combined with low morbidity and short duration of surgery. The procedure is planned and performed in a straightforward, standardized, and easy-to-learn fashion. The high cost effectiveness and the steep learning curve will encourage the spread of this new technique even into smaller centers. Thus, minimally invasive percutaneous nephrolithotripsy, or MIP, will fulfill the expectations made of modern stone treatment.